This is Sean Mice here, and in today's information, in today's presentation, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you each of the primary pieces of my information business, the way that my information business runs, so literally real-life information, and what I'm also going to do is give you the background that I believe that you need to know so that you can determine where you fit into building or deepening your info business. So let's go ahead and get started. The first thing that I want to give is really just a casual definition of how I see an info business. Okay, and an info business or an information marketing business, in my personal casual definition, is a business in which we are selling information, knowledge, or expertise. Okay, now that information, knowledge, or expertise can be sold, it can be delivered in the medium of perhaps a written material, so a book or an online ebook delivery, perhaps even a membership delivery, website access, perhaps with written material. Could also be delivered with audio material. So it could be delivered as a CD, could be delivered as, you know, the form of an MP3, could be delivered as something visual, depending on the niche, could be delivered as a video, a webinar, could be delivered as DVD type of information. The information could also be delivered in a mentoring or a coaching format. And that could be in a one-on-one environment. That could be a one-on-several environment, maybe a small group of 5 to 10 people. Or it could be a large group of, you know, 100 people or perhaps even 1,000 individuals. Okay? Sometimes when talking about the information marketing business, even though I've just used the casual definition that I use, sometimes it's easy for us to mix in other types of internet businesses. Because while an info business or an information marketing business online fits into the category of internet marketing, there's a lot of internet marketing that goes on that is not information marketing or info business. Okay? So I'll just list what some of those are. Okay? I'm not talking about a business that is primarily an affiliate business, okay? Primarily an affiliate business where the core driver of our business is selling other people's products to other people, okay? Now, having said that, obviously affiliate products could be a part of that information selling process, okay? However, when I think of an information marketing business in its purest form, okay, it is the expert delivery of expert level information or knowledge by primarily the expert. Okay? Now, this is the only area where there may be some overlap because obviously in owning an information business, you certainly might promote someone else's product as part of your system and others might promote for you. I think for me personally, the biggest distinguishing factor here is that the business is not based on this affiliate marketing principle. However, instead, it is based on the personal, although possibly automated or mass delivery of your expert information, not necessarily other people's. Okay. My definition does not include get-rich-quick schemes. Okay, so there's unfortunately so many beginners fall prey to websites that simply claim that if you purchase their website and clone their website or get your own cloned version of their website or sell their cloned material that you can get rich quick by purchasing it once and reselling it 1,000 times. Okay, and so I'm also excluding that from my personal definition of information marketing or information business. I'm also excluding MLM and network marketing. Okay, and I'm not necessarily excluding them because they're models that don't work. And by the way, I'm not necessarily excluding affiliate businesses or, regardless of the ethicality or morality of get-rich-quick schemes, okay, I'm not excluding any of these because they don't necessarily work, I'm also not placing a stamp of approval saying that they do. Okay, I'm simply indicating they don't belong as part of our definition. I'm also excluding catalog or auction businesses, okay, like Zappos or Amazon or eBay. Okay, so an information marketing business is generally, you know, does not sell 1,000 different catalog items like you might find at a successful company like Zappos. Again, a great business model, at least for Zappos, great business model. Again, that's not what we're dealing with when we talk about an information marketing business. Also, not primarily talking about a software provider. Okay, so perhaps a company that develops a new type of software that can be used online and, you know, resultantly sells that software to 1,000 or 1,000,000 end users, whatever the case is. Okay, that list of excluded types of businesses is not an exhaustive list. It's simply reinforcing the idea for me personally of what an info business is simply by indicating what it is not. Okay, now, kind of going back to this idea of information marketing, I personally believe that when we create an information marketing business, the intention should be for us to be teaching other people, whether it's through a book, a CD, a DVD, an MP3, a webinar, personal coaching, whatever the case is, I personally believe that we should be teaching from our own store of expert level material. I believe that there is a common pervasive problem on that line, and that is folks that are told or taught or think of it on their own that they can create what they believe to be a genuine information marketing business where they are simply regurgitating information that perhaps they have learned from one other source, or perhaps they have scoured the web for free information that they can package up and pretend to be an expert simply by regurgitating information. I believe that a true information marketer, one who is destined to generate at least a full-time income online, and for some individuals, depending on how they scale, and I'll talk about this later, how they scale, okay, a business that can go far beyond a full-time income. And I don't personally believe that that can happen very readily with a business that is based on regurgitating learned information from other people. I believe that that expertness needs to come from within us. Okay, now, having said that, obviously, in order for any of us to become an expert, there's one of two ways to get there. And in most cases, most experts do both of these. Okay, and one of those ways is to learn the information. The second is to use the information until we are as comfortable with the information as might place us in that expert status. Okay, we are more comfortable with the information than perhaps 95 or 98% of other people that have the information. Okay, now, obviously we have to have a distinction because we probably could stretch what I've just given you as a bit of a definition about this regurgitating the information as saying, you know, if someone were to go out, learn from 25 different individuals, internalize that information, and then reteach that. Some might say that's a stretch on this idea of regurgitating. In my opinion, and for the course of our conversation, I don't believe that that's the case. If that individual is genuinely attempting mastery of the material, I believe that this idea of regurgitation happens when someone studies from perhaps one or two individuals, takes that information without trying, testing it, using it, proving it, becoming, again, a personally using that information in its expert levelness and simply passing it on. Okay, I hope that that right there has been clear. Here's the thing. One of the things that I see online from some people who teach the concept of information marketing or internet marketing is this idea that someone should choose their passion and simply follow their passion and the money will follow. Okay, now, in some cases, if your passion is in an area that is a lucrative or a profitable area, then certainly you could follow your passion. However, unfortunately, I see so many people whose passion is something that so few people on earth have any desire in, that no matter how good you become at your passion, you're simply not going to be able to monetize it. Okay? And so, in my opinion, obviously, if your goal as an internet marketer is simply to further your passion and money is not a consideration, it's simply a furthering your passion or your hobby, and you want to treat it like a passion or a hobby, and there's no stress about not monetizing it, then I say fine, and for sure, follow your passion. Okay? However, if your primary objective online is to generate revenue, I believe that instead you should look for a niche, an area online that will produce the money. And if that area is not consistent or is not the same as your passion or hobby, but you still want to pursue your passion or hobby, excellent. Generate money in the profitable niche area online. Use a portion of that money to promote your passion. Okay? Let's talk now about choosing a profitable niche. How do we go about choosing a profitable niche? And just a quick comment on some of the ways I see people from time to time indicating how you might find a profitable niche. One of the things that I see people looking at as an indicator is how many searches are done for a particular topic. Okay, and personally, I don't believe that's a good indicator of the profitableness of a niche. It only tells us how many people are searching for a keyword. Okay, now, some people would add to that definition. They would say, okay, in addition to selecting how much demand there is, meaning how many searches there are, let's find out how many people are meeting needs in that niche. Okay, and then they're able to come up with some type of a quotient that indicates to them demand for that keyword, okay, versus the amount of people that are perhaps meeting that demand. You know, in my opinion, again, this is not necessarily effective. Surely, sometimes it overlaps and allows us to perhaps see into an area that might have some potential. However, it doesn't tell us how profitable that particular niche is, okay? In fact, if we were to see that something has a lot of keyword interest and very few people selling in that keyword, it might simply tell us that it's a very unprofitable niche, and that's why no one is selling in that niche. And so, therefore, I believe that using keyword-type searches and an evaluation of how many people are meeting those particular needs in a vacuum, just what I've just described, which is what I see so many people getting into internet marketing feeling like they need to find, is lots of keyword searches and, you know, a small amount of people selling to that particular area. What I believe that we need to do, and I've found that using the types of techniques that I've just shared with you can be, or that I'm getting ready to share with you, can be very, very indicative of future profitability of a niche. Okay, and I'll just share them with you and we'll discuss this a little bit. I believe that in today's market, today's evolved market, where people have been looking for a very long time for, you know, in obviously the total scheme of history, not a very long time in the scheme of how long has the internet been around, really a large portion of this time, okay, folks have been looking for these holes, these places that they can monetize. In my opinion, the bulk of those areas are being monetized, okay? And so what that tells me is that, and I believe that real-world results show this, I believe that we can see this. In fact, if you were to go online and find a list or create a list if there doesn't exactly exist a list exactly like what I'm going to share with you. Find the 25 individuals online that generate the most revenue. My guess is that you'll find that they are in a tightly organized set of niches, okay? Niches that perhaps or possibly tend to be more profitable. I'm not saying that a particular niche, just because it sits outside of the so-called profitable niches, would not be. However, the question would be, when getting started, when choosing a niche, you know, do we want to haphazardly guess at maybe having a 1 in 100 chance of guessing a niche that other people have not found to be profitable that might work for us, or simply getting into a profitable niche at the very beginning? So I believe that in order to find that profitable niche, you'll go somewhere that you can readily see the information of what other people are purchasing. One great place to do that is a website like Amazon, especially since we're talking about the information marketing business. Okay, we are selling information, and if we think about it, when you purchase a book, when a person purchases a book, when a buyer online purchases a book, they're generally not buying it for its aesthetic value to place on a shelf and look good on a shelf. They're generally purchasing that book for the information that is contained within its covers. Okay, now, because we're in information marketing, and because we see that people that purchase, or that particular topics that more people purchase books for, then because they are purchasing the information between the covers and not necessarily the book itself for its physical book value, what we often find is that topics that sell well as nonfiction books also, if that information is put into a product funnel with MP3s, with deeper information, with DVDs, with coaching, with consulting, okay, with selling expert-level knowledge, what we find is, in my opinion, we find there's a high correlation between information marketing businesses that are profitable and productive and the level of buying activity that occurs on websites such as Amazon in that particular niche area. And the beautiful thing about websites such as Amazon, okay, is that through a few different types of searches, you're able to find out what areas sell more, what types of products have more best sellers, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, now, in conjunction with this, what we also want to do, okay, is, and again, I'm going to give you about three different things you can use here in terms of choosing a niche. I don't believe that any of these should stand alone, meaning I don't believe you should just go to Amazon, find a bestseller, and simply say, okay, I can go in and compete and that will be profitable. However, I believe matched up with the next few things I'm going to share with you, I believe that if there's a yes answer to all of these, if it's positive for all of these, you've probably chosen a profitable niche. The next thing that I would suggest is to go to a pay-per-click company. Okay, as I record this now, Google is a good place to go for this information. Okay, I can't say that you'll always be able to use Google. My guess is another company, if Google does not continue to provide this information, another company will. Okay. However, with Google, it's fairly easy once you get into their system. Okay, it is, obviously when I say getting into their system, you can simply do it by going to Google AdWords. There's nothing shady about getting into their system and finding out what are people paying to advertise in that particular topic. Okay, and so what we do is we generally see a correlation between high dollars that people are willing to pay to advertise in that topic and a high level of monetization. Okay, it's difficult for us to look at a particular day snapshot, you know, or just go to, you know, a search engine and see who's advertising today and say, okay, just because they're advertising today, that means that they're profitable. Okay, now what we can do if we go into a search engine such as Google or Yahoo or some of the others, and we find that the same advertiser is advertising month after month after month after month, well, we probably can assume that that campaign is a winning campaign or it would not continue to be run. Okay, now that's information that does take longer to develop. It's not something that you can develop overnight. Okay, now, once we've determined that there is demand for that information, we find that from Amazon, we find that there's advertiser demand for a particular topic, what we can also do is use a keyword tool, such as the Google keyword tool, okay, to determine what seed keywords we might begin our campaigns with. Okay, I really want to stress the idea of seed keywords. When we search and we do keyword research, I believe that for the most part, that keyword research should be the beginning. It should only give us a starting place. And here's why. I believe that in most cases, the commonly searched for keywords in a particular market are not the money keywords. They're not the profitable keywords. Okay? And if we want to just think about this, we want to just have perhaps a mental exercise. Hey, think about the last piece of information you were looking for online. Okay? My guess is you typed in a generic keyword of sorts. You typed it in. You looked at the results. Nothing really looked right there, so you added one more word to your keyword search, and you might have found one result that wasn't really what you're looking for, but in reading that result, there was some phrase on it that made sense. Maybe that's closer to what I'm looking for. So now you go away from your keywords, you type in that phrase, you get a couple more results that look good, but they're not exactly what you want. And then you think about it again, and you rephrase that phrase into a question, and you type that in. It's not just right, and you keep moving it around. And 25 keywords later, you finally hit on exactly the right question to dig into what your need is, and you become monetized, or the company that markets that particular information monetizes their campaign through that particular search, not through the other, for example, 24 keywords that you used to get there. Okay, now, in my opinion, the only way to find out what those keywords are, there's two primary ways that you can do that. One is tracking, you know, the keyword usage that people use on your particular site, if you can structure your site in such a way that people are able to go through a process of searching right there on your site, you're able to see those keyword results, and you're able to see what monetizes, okay? You can also do that if you're advertising somewhere like Google AdWords. You can see which keywords monetize and which ones don't, okay? However, I believe that in even better place, and I've built my business on this premise, and that is the idea that our subscribers and buyers can tell us the exact language that they use when they're searching. Okay, and I find that by simply querying our subscribers and our buyers to find out what their biggest challenges are as it relates to the particular niche, or we could even say loosely here, a particular keyword family, okay? We will find that the language that they use to tell us what their challenges are is the same language that we are able to use to monetize searches online, okay? And if we're using something like article marketing as I do, or perhaps blog marketing, or any other type of content marketing, if we use those phrases that come to us from our subscribers and buyers, if we use those particular phrases, then what we find is that the traffic generated to the pages using those phrases tend to monetize at a much, much higher level. And so what this means to me, what I've done in my business personally for years, it's been highly profitable, is although we may start with keywords as our starting point, we create a bank of key thoughts of the actual phrases people use to search for information using the methods that I have just given you. Okay, now that we've chosen a niche, we have a profitable niche, we see that our niche is profitable, Okay, we're moving into, we're starting out with some keywords only for the purpose of getting started. Once we've gotten started, we, as we're building our list, we're building buyers, then we're querying those individuals to find out what the deeper thoughts are that they're actually using to search for terms that long run monetize. Okay, then we get into an actual business. I believe that in our information marketing business, there are four primary areas that we have to master in order to be a good information marketer. I believe that if any one of these four areas is not developed, then we are not maximizing the revenue that we could generate from a particular niche. And I also believe that in many cases, if one of these is totally missing, we will have very little, if any, revenue. I also believe that if we have our information marketing business developed, but it's not generating the revenue that we'd like it to, if we look and we find out what the weak parts of these particular areas are, and we fix those weak links, that in most cases, assuming, going back to this idea that we're not just regurgitating information, but we are genuinely experts ourselves, okay, that our revenue will improve as we strengthen each one of these four areas, or like I like to say, four pillars of information marketing. I'll give you these four. I'll just kind of name them, and then I'll go through step by step what each of these are and kind of go into some depth on these. The first one, and by the way, and I'm going to give these to you in an order. I'm going to give them to you in the chronological order that someone would come through your system. However, the order that they come through your system is not the same order that you will build these pillars, okay? And I'll explain more of that in just a moment. The first pillar is traffic. The second pillar is building a list of followers. The third pillar is building a relationship with those followers and determining their needs. And the fourth pillar is the method that we use to meet their needs through the distribution of the information, okay? And we're going to call this pillar products. However, it may not be what we think of as being a physical product. It may be, an ebook. It may be a physical book. It may be audio. It may be video. It might be consulting. It might be coaching. Okay, we're throwing all that under the pillar of products simply because it's an easy way for us to think about it, but we really want to understand that we're not selling a product. We are selling the expert information that we've gathered over time. Okay, now, I specifically indicated that this is the method that someone goes through our system. They become traffic initially. Perhaps they visit one of our articles or our blog posts, or perhaps we're paying for pay-per-click advertising, so we send them there that way. We're buying banner advertising. We're buying ads on other people's lists, easing advertising. We're driving that traffic. They come to our website. They become a follower, whether they join a formal list, as I advocate, or they simply become a follower of perhaps a blog or a content site. Okay. Once that occurs, once they become a follower, in my opinion, again, preferably on a subscriber list, but possibly also in a blog or another content environment, then that individual, we begin to build a relationship, a trust-based relationship with that particular individual through, generally because of the size of the operation that we're running, to make it a full-time income or better. Okay, we're doing it through automated means. Okay, and then the final place that someone goes in this particular set of pillars is they purchase that information from us. They may purchase once, they may purchase twice, they may purchase 25 times, they may become a lifetime client. Okay, and that's the order that they come through. Now, in building our business, it becomes almost counterintuitive here. We cannot build our business in necessarily the exact same order that people come in. Okay, and that is this idea that if we were to build a traffic pillar first, but we didn't have any method of them becoming a follower, okay, so we weren't building a list perhaps, we weren't developing a relationship through an autoresponder series, and we didn't have anything to send to them as information, then even if we had a fully developed traffic pillar, our business wouldn't work. Okay. So what we generally do when we're building initially is we start with the place where people can become our followers. Okay, and in my opinion, the best place for that is a place where they can become subscribers, whether that's through a squeeze page, whether that's through an opt-in form on a content site like a blog site, okay, whether that's a reverse type of squeeze page, whether it is self-liquidating offer where we give people the option of, instead of joining our list for free, they make some small purchase or some large purchase, and then they become a follower after having made that initial purchase, okay? I believe that we need that piece in place first, initially, before we begin to drive traffic. Once that piece is in place, then we can begin driving traffic, and we can begin putting the things in place that will drive traffic. Now, we're still missing the other two pieces, and that is our relationship component that is probably driven through an autoresponder, and we may also be missing products. So at the same time as that traffic is beginning to build, we are also going to begin to build that relationship with people as they come in, and we are going to begin to offer them, we're going to begin to create products based on their needs. Okay, now, one of the mistakes that I see often is people coming in and kind of bypassing a lot of what we've discussed, including searching for a profitable niche. But we could even see someone coming in, finding a profitable niche, and deciding on their own what would then be a product that people need, starting with the product, then building an autoresponder campaign that builds for the product, that promotes the product, then building a squeeze page that promotes the autoresponder campaign, then driving traffic to it, and then finding that the people who come into their list don't want what they offer. And so in my opinion, and what I've done in my business for years, is I begin by driving that traffic and building a list, and then simply asking those individuals what their challenges are. My theory is this, and this has been fleshed out as in my opinion, it's truth. It works for me repeatedly and consistently over time. And that is that if someone is sharing with me that they have a challenge, I believe that that's a current challenge. Okay, now, if it's a current challenge, I then make the logical assumption that somebody else is not meeting that need or solving that challenge for that individual, because if they were, they wouldn't have that challenge currently. And so I therefore conclude that if they have a challenge, someone else is not meeting that challenge for them, and if I create a product that meets that challenge, that solves that problem, and obviously that I present it correctly and it's priced correctly for the value of the challenge, that they will buy it for me. And I have proven time and time again, year after year after year, with my own marketing, that indeed is the case. Okay, so we start with a way to develop subscribers. I'm not going to go into detail on how we would do that at this point. A few different ways we can do is using a squeeze page, a page that has as its only purpose the opting in of subscribers. Usually, in most cases, I think we see giving away some type of free gift in exchange for a name and email. The second way would be through other types of opt-ins, perhaps on blogs or content networks, or our own blog and content sites. And then another method of bringing them in might be something of a reverse squeeze page, where people go through several pages of content before they're actually offered an opt-in. What we tend to see happen here is that opt-in rates are lower. However, the quality of those individuals coming in is higher. There's pros and cons to doing something along those lines. The pro is that those individuals on the list have been filtered to even a higher degree than perhaps they might come through article marketing, allows us to be more specific in our targeting. Okay, the con is we simply don't have as much volume, and so there's a balance that needs to happen. And another way that we can create a list of followers is through the selling of perhaps low ticket items. Okay, and speaking of, earlier on we mentioned this idea of affiliate marketing, and you know, I specifically ruled it out as we're not going to build our business based on affiliate marketing. However, what a lot of marketers do, and I believe it fits in right here, is that they create their own products, they hire affiliates to promote those products, they pay the affiliate some percentage or even 100% of whatever revenue comes from that product, okay? And those individuals who have purchased that product become their subscribers or their followers, okay? And so I believe that using affiliate marketing in this place allows us, again, to create highly qualified subscribers. So very targeted use of affiliate marketing. So the second thing we're going to do is begin to drive traffic. Obviously, my method is article marketing and content websites. There's many other ways to generate traffic, and I'm not going to go into all of those, probably not, except in passing, going to mention what any of those are right here. However, I will say this. I believe that any traffic source on earth that is profitable is generally only profitable for those individuals who become an expert or a master at that sort of traffic. And what I see so often is that people, because they see that many sources of traffic or drive traffic, drive visitors, and drive profits for their competitors, they believe that if they simply drive the same sorts of traffic, that they can be profitable. Unfortunately, when that happens, you know, let's just say you start with, we'll have an exaggeration here, 10 sorts of traffic. You're never able, or at least within, say, the first few years, okay, which is when you need to become profitable, okay, it makes it very difficult to ever become an expert at any of those sorts of traffic. And if your competitor is an expert in one of those sources of traffic, and if you're blindly copying the traffic sources of your competitors, then your competitors are an expert at making that particular traffic convert. So if you're, let's just say you're doing pay-per-click marketing, you want to do it because your competitor is, they've been doing it for 5 years, they know exactly what words convert and how to convert it, and they know what their return on investment is for every keyword out there, you go in and try to compete with that. Well, frankly, you can't initially. You need to become an expert. You know, same thing with, let's say, article marketing. Okay, you see somebody that has done a great work in article marketing, a particular niche. You say, well, he or she is writing articles. I'll do the same thing. I'll be able to monetize it. Once again, if they're an expert at converting people from articles to buyers, okay, and you're not, then you're not going to be able to get the same level of results, okay? What we also see is that, and I'm kind of contrasting two radically different sources of traffic here, and there's dozens of other types of traffic that if I were to make a list, we'd talk about pay-per-click versus article marketing. My experience has been that in each sort of traffic, there's a different optimization path that people go through in becoming profitable on your list. And so what that means is that if we optimize our system for articles or for blog posts, then if we just drive pay-per-click traffic to the same place, we're probably not going to be profitable. And the same thing goes if we're an expert at driving pay-per-click traffic and we have learned the optimization process for someone to go from clicking on a three-line ad and becoming profitable. If we were to send article traffic to the same place, we probably would not become profitable without making additional changes. Now, one of the mistakes that some people make is they'll try to throw all their traffic in the same place and optimize it for all of them. When that happens, we see that profits tend to go radically down. And so my conclusion with this is it's far better to choose one source of traffic and become an expert than to have 10 sources of traffic where you're not. You know, the question might be raised, you know, what about people that have been in this business for a really long time and they're not an expert in any sort of traffic, but they're driving traffic in 10 different areas. They have a business that generates $30 million a year. They've got these multiple traffic sources. How do you explain that? My explanation for that is that, in my opinion, almost every single one of those individuals started out with an initial sort of traffic that they became an expert at, and they did one of two things. As they became an expert in one area of traffic, became a genuine expert, they said, hey, I'll add one more area on and become an expert there. Or as their revenue increased, they chose to take a percentage of that revenue, reinvest it into not just other traffic sources, but into an expert that could run their traffic for them. So if we look at big organizations, okay, that are driving lots of different sources of traffic, we find that they have experts on their staff that drive each of those sources of traffic. And for an entrepreneur, for a one-man or one-woman show or a five-man, five-woman show, okay, we have to be very, very careful that we don't just look at a $30 million or $100 million operation and say that we can copy it, because many times we cannot, because certain parts of their business are run by experts. And as one individual or as a small group of individuals, it's very difficult to duplicate that level of expertise across all areas. And as we grow, we can add those individuals on. Okay, the next pillar is building a relationship with our followers. In most cases, in my opinion, this is going to be an autoresponder campaign. This autoresponder campaign is going to consist of about five different types of emails that are going to be used to build relationship, and I'll just give you what those are. I believe that one type of email is a credibility builder, and I believe that we use these primarily, not necessarily primarily, but at the beginning of our campaign, we rely probably almost exclusively on these credibility builders, building emails, and then as our campaign ages, we will continue to use these, but perhaps not in their full force. A credibility email does something in that email to create credibility for the person with whom we're building a relationship, that we are a credible expert, that we are who we say that we are. There's many different ways that we can do this. One is to refer those subscribers or followers to our published works. If we have a published book, great. If we do not, okay, then we might move them to a published article. We may move them to several published articles online. We may use a recording of expert-level information, and this can be a 10-minute recording. It can be a 2-hour recording. This recording should have as its primary purpose not selling the individual anything, okay, but simply allowing them to see that we really are an expert by teaching them something on that particular recording. We may also have a link to a consulting page or a testimonials page. There's other ways that we can do this, just giving you some examples here. The second type of email that we might have in our email campaign is a content email. And this could almost fall into this area of credibility, simply because the content email is going to not only help that individual in teaching them something particular, but that content email is also going to show if the material in the content is of an expert level, okay, that you are an expert. Then what we're going to begin to see is a movement, not necessarily away from credibility and content, but towards monetization, okay, which is going to be a process of finding out what those subscribers on our list need, what their challenges are, okay. And we may do this through emails that ask those subscribers questions. We may also have emails that move people towards a solution, which may be purchasing one of our products. Perhaps it's moving people towards purchasing someone else's product. Okay? So again, a limited use of affiliate marketing. You know, let's just say that you have a business, you're just starting out, you are an expert, but you only have one product, and there's four areas where your clients really need your help. You may initially market an affiliate product to meet those other needs. However, over time, you'll create your own. Let's say on down the road, you have 10 products, but there's 11 needs in your marketplace, then you will find someone in your market who teaches the information that you're missing, and again, you'll move people towards that affiliate product until such time as you decide that you'll create your own product, if ever. Okay, I believe that there's a place you can have a small number of affiliate products. Again, we're not building the business on those. Okay. And then the final step, okay, and really this relationship building and this next step go hand in hand. I'm giving you this, kind of in this order, it's the way I gave you the pillars. However, our relationship building campaign is only going to go really as far as the information that we're able to offer. And in doing that, we need to create products. We need to write ebooks. We need to write books. We may do audio recordings, MP3s. We may do DVDs, webinars, videos. We may offer consulting, coaching, mentoring, etc. And we will create products to meet those needs. We might also create membership-type use products. So this could be written material like a book. This could be recorded material like an MP3. This could be video type or webinar type material like a DVD. Okay, but instead of a one-time purchase, this might be a membership purchase. So, you know, instead of purchasing one MP3 today, someone purchases a monthly MP3 membership, for example. I tell you what I'd like to do on this product is just give you a quick outline of how you can create easily initially ebooks, recordings, or coaching programs. And we can do this fairly quickly. Okay, and what I teach is a concept called a 10x10 matrix. And a 10x10 matrix is an idea of going into your niche, your particular niche, and choosing for yourself in that niche. And this can be in combination with asking your subscribers what their challenges are. 10 to 12 areas in under your niche or under the topic of the new product that you're going to create, areas that you could teach about. Okay, and this is really just going to be a quick and dirty outline type of a form, okay, where we list what these are. Then what we're going to do is we're going to take each one of those sub ideas and create one of two, maybe three different types of lists beneath each one. Okay, one thing that we could do is just simply break down each one of those points into 10 deeper points. What I find that works extremely well, though, is creating a set of steps, 5 steps, 10 steps, 15 steps to accomplishing whatever that particular line is. And so if we come up with 5, 10, 15 steps for each one of the 10, 12, maybe 15 ideas that we're going to teach about in our ebook or our MP3 or our coaching program, we'll come out with what I call a 10x10 matrix. It can be a 12x15. It can be a 12x12. It can be a 10x5, really. Okay, but the idea is that we want to get as close to 10x10 as possible so that we have at least 100 specific subtopics on which we can teach. Once we have this, we have several choices. Okay, we can write a page of content on each one of these ideas. This will give us a 100-page ebook. And I really am simplifying this. If a particular topic needs 5 pages of information to deal with it, write 5 pages. If a particular topic only needs half a page, write half a page. This is really just an oversimplification of the process. However, I find that when my clients start with an outline just like this, a completed outline, they're able to very quickly create their ebook. The same thing in creating an MP3 or a webinar series. I find that if we simply break down each of these 100 components into 10 sets of 10 topics, we can literally teach for only 6 minutes on each topic and come up with 10 hours of teaching. Again, 6 minutes may not be the right number. A particular topic may need 20 minutes of information at a particular level. May need 2 minutes of information, okay? And through the course of recording that information, we'll come up with a series of recordings that can be marketed as an MP3 series or a CD series, or if it's video type or webinar type material, it could be a DVD or a downloadable video series. We can also create a coaching program using the same idea. So we could write a lesson on each one of the 100 topics and have a 100-day coaching program where people got one lesson delivered every single day through their autoresponder. We could have a 10-lesson program that contained all 10 ideas and maybe was delivered every 2 weeks, so it'd be a 20-week coaching program. Okay. We could deal with two topics a week for 52 weeks or for 50 weeks. We'd have a one-year coaching program. We can deliver that coaching information as written material. We can convert it into a PDF. We could deliver it as MP3 or DVD material. Okay. Or we can deliver it as a combination of both. Okay. So we could have, you know, let's just say, for example, an hour's worth of MP3 recorded material along with a written, a written homework assignment that gave some step-by-step instructions to utilizing the information on that MP3. We can do the same thing with a membership. So if we have our 10x10 matrix outline, again, could be 12x15, 12x12, 12x10, it's this matrix idea that's critical here. We could create a membership. We could have a 100-week membership program where someone receives some content once a week. They could receive content once a month following this structure. Let's just say that we have an open-ended program. We initially create 1 year's worth of material. At the end of that year, every single month, we'd simply create another lesson to tag on to the end of it. This gives us a membership. Okay, now, I realize that in giving you these quick and dirty outlines, it almost feels like I'm simplifying the product creation process. However, I believe that's an antidote for what so many people do with product creation, and that is take a year or more to create a product that, frankly, in many cases, could be created in a week or two or 3 weeks. And unfortunately, or fortunately, you know, depending on the perspective here, you know, if you're wanting to build an internet business now, you probably don't want to wait a year and a half to have a product created. Instead, you want to begin delivering product as quickly as possible. One of the things that I have found in my business, and I see this consistently across the board, is that generally speaking, this is going to be a generalization here, but it's certainly the case for me and for many others in information marketing, and that is that the more products you have, the more money that you make and the more that you sell. Now, obviously, you couldn't just go out and create 25 products and not have traffic and not have subscribers, but what we do see is that generally when people have more products, they tend to drive more traffic. When they have more products, they might get more people to promote for them. When they have more products, they're able to go into more niches. When they have more products, individuals are able to purchase from them multiple times rather than just making one purchase. What I'd like to give you now is a possible, I hesitate to call it a suggested, but a possible structure of your product funnel to get to three specific places online. One would be a $5,000 a month income, one would be a $20,000 a month income, and one would be a $100,000 a month income. Now, before I do this, I just want to let you know this is a possible structure. You can add to it, you can subtract to it, you can scale it up, okay? You can add more products to it. But what I wanted to do is give you something that you could wrap your mind around in terms of some price points and the number of something that would have to be sold. But keep in mind, if you double the price, you only have to sell half as many. If you decide you want to sell twice as many, you can cut the price in half and you'll still get to the same number. So the possibilities that I'm going to give you here are totally and endlessly expandable. I just want to give you something that you can sink your mind around. Okay, so the first one would be, you know, a suggested way or a possible way to get to $5,000 a month. And one way to do that would be to have a $27 product and a $100 product. So this might be a $27 ebook and a $100 10 MP3 series. Okay, and we would sell 100 units at $27 for revenue of $2,700 plus 25 units at $100 for an additional $2,500. That'd be a total of $5,200 minus some merchant fees. We're probably right at the $4,900, $5,000 level. And I believe based on, you know, my own work, my own numbers, my clients' numbers, that generally what we see if we have a good ebook, that 20-25% of the people that purchase that ebook, if they're properly marketed to and they're properly built a relationship, they'll upgrade and purchase that next item. Okay, now notice that if we didn't have two items here, we'd make half the revenue. So that second item is important. let's bump up and say, hey, how would we go from $5,000 a month to $20,000 a month? Okay, now, there's a couple of different ways we could do it. I mean, one, we could just say, hey, let's just sell four times as much of these two products, 400 times 27 and 100 times 100. And, you know, that, if my math serves me right, that should be about $20,000. That'd be one way to do it. However, I believe there's an easier way to do it, and I believe that easier way is instead of just driving more traffic and putting more people into the funnel, instead create more products. So the possible matrix I give you here for this will include both. So we're going to double our front-end transactions. So we're going to have 200 sales at $27, okay, instead of 100. We're going to double our entry point. And then what we're going to do is we're also going to double the next item sales. So instead of selling 25 units at $100, we're going to sell 50 units at $100. Yeah, that should put us close to the $10,000 mark. Okay, and then we're going to need to have another $10,000 in sales. There's a few different ways that we can structure that. Okay, we could sell an additional 40 units at, say, $250. This might be a home study course. This might be a CD series. This could be a webinar series. Okay, we could also sell, instead of 40 times 250, we could sell 20 units at $500, okay, which, in my opinion, if we're selling 200 at 27 and 50 at 100, probably if we have the material, again, we're an expert, we're always working with the idea that we have expert material, that people want the material, that it's in a niche that they need, you know, I find that that's a pretty realistic number, 20 times 500. Now, that would get us to the $20,000. Now, what we could do instead is create a coaching program. So what would we need in a coaching program to generate $20,000? If we had $10,000 coming from our first two products, then we would need to fill in a gap of $10,000. Say we had a $200 a month coaching program, we would need 50 individuals in that coaching program to generate the $10,000. Now, that won't happen the first month, but let's say that we have a 12-month coaching program, then on average we might add 4 or 5 new coaching clients every month, and ignoring attrition at the end of 1 year, then we would have that revenue. Okay, factoring attrition in, we might say, you know, instead of selling 4 or 5 units per month at $200 a month, we'll sell 10, okay, and we'll get to that 50 number, and we'll continue to sell, and we'll have attrition, and at the end of, say, a 6 to 12 month period of time, we are now at this $20,000 level. We could mix and match that any way that we wanted. Okay, now, to move up to $100,000, we could do the same thing. I mean, we could just simply multiply everything times 5, have 5 times more traffic on the front end, sell 5 times more $27 products, sell 5 times more $100 products, have 5 times as many coaching clients. Okay? Or we could add in more additional products. Okay? And so what we could have here is we could have multiple funnels. So in our $20,000 model, we said we'd have 200 units at 27. Well, maybe now we'll have 5 products, have 200 units of each product at 27. Okay, maybe we'll have 200 sales at $100 for an additional $20,000. And then now we come to this bridge, this break point. You know, do we create our next product as a higher ticket? Do we make it a coaching product? I submit to you, I'm going to give you a number, and then I'll show you how you can break it down in different ways. What we want to do is on a monthly basis, we want to generate, given the model I just gave you, okay, which is 1,000 times 27, and then 200 times 100, and we might have one more product in there to generate another $20,000. Maybe we would have a $500 product at 40 units a month, which, again, should be an easy number to get to if we've got 1,000 $27 products on the front end. Okay, it leaves us $40,000 to get to 100 grand. We can do that a few different ways. We can sell 40 units a month at $1,000 or something high ticket. You know, this might be a 12-week coaching program that comes with a DVD or CD series. That's a pretty common number there. Or we could have a coaching program that, let's say, is 5 months long, is $200 a month payments, meaning that if someone comes in for 5 months times $200, it's $1,000 of revenue per client, okay, and we have 40 of those clients generated every single month. Again, I feel like with 1,000 units of 27 sold on the front end, that's a pretty realistic number given the numbers that I do and what my clients do. Okay, moving on. So at this point, I've covered not only kind of determining the niche, determining, you know, you know, what is our information marketing business supposed to look like? You know, do we need to become an expert? And yes, I believe we should not only become an expert or be an expert in our topic. I believe that we need to master each of these pillar areas. Okay, and I'll talk about that just a bit more in a moment. At this point now, we have our four pillars. We have traffic, we have subscribers or followers, we have a relationship, and we have products. There's a couple of things that I believe, there's a few things that I believe that we need to plug in additionally here if we're really going to grow to the next level. Okay, one I believe is critical that we start learning at the very beginning. However, it takes time. Again, the second one is one that I believe that we should start with as soon as possible, but I believe is going to be required to get, you know, much past the full-time income. Okay, and these two areas, I'll give you the first one first, okay, and that is learning to write persuasively, particularly in the arena of writing emails and writing sales letters. Okay, now, each of the things that I've given you as pillars so far are things that literally you can purchase knowledge and instruction on how to drive traffic, on how to create subscribers, on how to build a relationship, and on how to create products, and pretty much follow a paint-by-numbers type of system for each one of those. Okay, do this, you'll get traffic, do this, you'll get subscribers, do this, you get build relationship, do this, you'll create products. And although each of those areas could certainly be improved over time, you can get a fairly strong foundation in any of those areas, in my opinion, very, very quickly. Especially if you're learning from the right person and they're really able to break those things down for you. However, in my opinion, copywriting is something that takes practice to get good at. Okay? Now, there's two theories, two primary areas of thought as it comes to copywriting, especially sales letters, and even in the email arena for information marketers. And we'll talk about number two first. And that is that some information marketers, you know, especially million-dollar, multi-million-dollar operations, simply hire professional copywriters and email writers, okay, and simply have them do that work for them. Okay, another thing that they'll do sometimes is hire individuals in-house and teach them how to do the work. Okay, in many of those cases, the individuals that are hiring copywriters, however, have learned to do it themselves. However, the business has gotten so big they can no longer do it themselves. Okay, and without, you know, actually counting heads, my guess would be that most multi-million-dollar information marketers, although they probably don't write their own copy today, they have learned to do it, and the biggest reason they don't today is because of the time constraint, you know, to write all the copy that needs to be written. Okay, can this be completely outsourced in the beginning? Yes, I believe that it can be. However, I believe that you can grow faster if you'll simply begin to learn to do it yourself. Now, you can do this in conjunction with hiring other people. Okay? So, for example, you know, you might take a couple of copywriting courses. I don't believe that there's any course on earth that is going to be able to teach you in such a way that you don't need any additional information. I don't believe, and just like any of the other pillars, I believe that there's always going to be room for improvement and that you can always learn more. I believe with copywriting, it's especially critical that you continue to learn more because you don't want your copy to just look like everybody else's. You want to be able to find your own voice. And in my opinion, not only do you need the instruction here, but you need the practice. I don't believe that you should only sit down to write a sales letter once every 6 months, if that's when you release a product, is every 6 months. You should be practicing writing a sales letter every 2 weeks, even if it's one you're not going to use. Now, an easy way out of this is just create a new product every 2 weeks and write a sales letter. What you'll find is 20 sales letters down the road, especially if you're taking some classes, if you're reading some books, if you're studying and practicing, your 20th letter's going to be a lot better than the first one. Okay, the second additional item that I believe that you want to develop some level of mastery with is outsourcing. I believe that you need to have outsourcing in your business if you're going to go past, possibly even reach, a full-time income with information marketing. And I'm not talking about outsourcing everything that you do, certainly not at the beginning, but I'm not a big proponent of outsourcing product creation, especially initially when you are the expert. I believe you should be creating your own products. And I believe I've given you the formula earlier today to make that product creation simple and easy and make it possible for you so that you can grow into bigger and bigger products as time goes on. I believe you should be creating your own products and not outsourcing that initially. There's a number of different reasons. One of those is that, you know, if you are the expert and you have someone else create the product, it's probably not going to live up to your own expert requirements. However, there are some things that we can outsource, that I outsource, that, you know, in my opinion, I mean, just kind of looking at numbers here, just about everybody that has a big company in the information marketing arena outsources some or all of this information, or all of this, and that is traffic generation. And in my case, obviously, that's articles. I outsource articles. I outsource web content. And I believe that for the most part, you can do the same thing. Now, when I talk about web content, I'm talking about traffic magnet type of content. I'm not talking about, you know, you want a blog post that specifically is teaching a particular topic and you want it in your voice and from you, obviously. But for traffic magnet content, you can use outsourcing for that. Also, you can outsource customer service. Okay. I do not recommend, you know, just totally outsourcing all of your email to the point that those outsourced individuals aren't able to write in your voice, okay, and that you don't have some level or a lot of level of control and oversight over that email, okay. However, I do believe that you can easily outsource, you know, pieces of customer service like, you know, I can't find the download page, I wasn't redirected right here, you know, how do I download this? How do I make a PDF, et cetera, et cetera. There's lots of those types of things in the customer service arena that you can outsource. As you grow, I believe you should outsource more and more. However, I believe that when you first start out, if you'll just simply set aside a percentage, 5%, 10% of all your revenue that comes in to put back into outsourcing, then when you grow and when you get big, you won't have this place where you say, okay, when do I start outsourcing? What do I let other people do? I'm so used to doing it all. What do I allow other people to do? Begin small. Begin allowing other people to do some of your work for you at the very, very beginning. You know, you could start with outsourcing some of your traffic. You could, you know, in my case, you know, I started by outsourcing articles that were written. As you kind of going back to the four pillars, some quick review on some ideas here. Obviously, as you're developing subscribers, you're also creating products. You're not going to create all your products first. You're not going to create all your subscribers first. Those two things are going to sort of go hand in hand. As you get subscribers, you're going to create products based on those needs. As you develop products and sell those products, you're able to start putting a dollar value on your subscribers. So subscribers worth X dollars per month or subscribers worth X dollars in total. This allows you to start feeling comfortable about adding additional traffic. Okay, so let's just say that you know that on average a subscriber's worth $40 to you. Okay, you know, then you could reasonably spend $5 per subscriber to get new subscribers. And obviously you may not be paying specifically for subscribers, you'd be paying for the traffic. Okay, and the way we might calculate that would be, let's say we invest $1,000, and with that $1,000 of traffic, we generate 333 subscribers. Okay, that would be a cost of, or an investment of $3 per subscriber. And if we know that we're monetizing at $40 per subscriber, then we know that our gross profit after traffic is $37 per subscriber. And I'm just throwing a number out there. I'm not saying that you shouldn't be higher than that or lower than that or any other number. As you become an expert in one source of traffic, you can begin to add on additional sources of traffic. two primary ways to grow. One is more entry points, meaning more products at the front end, more traffic sources, increases in traffic, et cetera, et cetera. The second way to grow is to create more back-end items so that you're constantly selling more to the existing traffic, or you can do a combination of both. Okay, folks, that's my model, and there's, 8, 10 critical areas that I've specifically gone into. Obviously, understanding what an information marketing business is, at least in my own casual definition, okay? Understanding and being able to find a profitable niche and being able to identify where those niche individuals are through a process of initial seed keywords and moving on to deeper needs through subscriber questions. Four pillars, traffic, follower generation, relationship creation, and products. Moving to copywriting and learning copywriting, becoming good at copywriting, and then outsourcing. In my opinion, you should learn how to do each of those particular areas from an expert, from someone who is an expert at doing each of those things. Okay? I don't believe that you should guess at how the right way to do any one of those parts would be, no more than if you needed to make a repair on your roof, that you would go up there, you'd look at it, and you would just guess the right way to do it if you didn't have the experience. You know, you'd either hire a roofer to teach you how to do it, you'd hire a roofer to do it for you, okay, or you may go somewhere like, you know, we have Home Depot here or a Lowe's or a hardware store, and you'd ask an experienced expert, what's the exact way to patch this hole in my roof so the next time it rains it won't come through. You're not going to guess at that. You know, the same thing is if you need a plumber, or let's say you've got a toothache, you know, you're not going to guess at how to fix that toothache. Instead, you're going to go to an expert that's trained in toothaches and or perhaps tooth extraction. And you'd go to an expert. And in all of these cases, you would go to an expert. You wouldn't go to someone who might hang out a shingle you're looking like an expert. Okay, so you wouldn't go to, have a tooth extracted. You know, you wouldn't go to a lemonade stand with a teenager behind the counter that says, hey, we extract teeth also. And on all of this to say, crazy example there, but all of this to say, just as in the offline world, we go to an expert when we need help. When we need legal help, we go to a legal expert. When we have need health help, we go to a health expert. We don't just guess what to do. In building your business, you should also do that. I also believe that you should become an expert in each of these areas. So if you are serious about building an information business, I believe it's your responsibility to become an expert in each one of these areas. I believe that one of the mistakes people make is they believe they're an expert in their area. And they're willing to become an expert perhaps in product creation, or they're willing to become an expert in driving traffic, but they're not willing to become an expert in all the other areas. And if they don't become an expert in those other areas, then the traffic generation or the product creation in this example just simply aren't going to have the same impact. And I believe that if you're building a business, you need to thoroughly understand all the aspects of it. Just like if you were to build an offline sandwich business, you would learn all the aspects of it. You would learn how to run the cash register. You would learn about marketing to get people to come in the front door. You would learn how to bake bread. You would learn how to put the meat on the bread to make the sandwich. You'd learn all of the different parts. You wouldn't just go out and hire a cashier and expect that they know how to run the register. You wouldn't just go out and hire a sandwich maker and hope they made good sandwiches. You would learn every part of your sandwich business so that when you hired someone new, you could say, this is how we make sandwiches here in our shop. And that's how intimately you should know your own information marketing business. You should know your business inside and out. Sure. Can you outsource parts of it? Yes, I recommend that. Can you hire people to drive traffic? Sure, I recommend that you do things like that. Can you hire people to add graphics to your products? Absolutely. However, I believe that you should personally take responsibility for knowing how all of those parts work together. My question to you would be, going along this idea of becoming an expert, okay, and almost referring back to the idea of becoming an literally being an expert in your own niche, you know, let's say that your income goal is $20,000 a month or it's $100,000 a month, you know, do you deserve to be paid that income or to be paid that revenue if you haven't mastered the material? And I primarily give that to you as a thought question, you know. And if the answer is no, you know, the question is, what level of mastery do you feel like you should get to before your subscribers, before the world is willing to pay you $20,000 or $100,000 a month or any number? I believe that your personal mastery, your personal level of expertise should be in line with what you expect to receive. You know, if you know, you think going back to the offline world, if you didn't know the work that you do, if you're an accountant and you weren't an expert at being an accountant, your boss would fire you. If you were a sandwich maker and you didn't make good sandwiches, you'd be fired. And if you claim to be an expert, but you're not really, if you only run your business halfway, in essence, you'll be fired by your customers, because they won't come back for more. Okay? And it's no different than the offline world. It's not like there's something special going on online. So my recommendation is be an expert in everything that you do, or hire an expert that can do that work for you. Do what it takes. Learn to manage your time. Get important things done. Be an expert. Know what needs to be done in your business. Everything else, you can outsource it. Choose if something is not important, if it doesn't belong in your business and you don't want to outsource it and it's wasting your time, don't do it. If it doesn't impact your business positively, just say, you know what, just because everybody on earth does this particular thing a certain way, I don't have to. My subscribers don't need it. My buyers don't need it. I don't need it. I'll take it out just because someone else does this particular thing. And I'm talking here along the lines of your time and resource management. Folks, I've given you the blueprint. Now it's time for you to go out and implement it.